You're listening to the Weekend Sport Podcast with Jason Pine from Newstalk ZB. The only place for the big names, the big issues, the big controversies, and the big conversations. It's all on Weekend Sport with Jason Pine on your home of sport, Newstalk ZB.
And welcome into the last Saturday edition of Weekend Sport for August 2024. It's August 31, last day of winter. Big day for sporting birthdays. Happy birthday, former All Blacks Grant Batty and Kieran Crowley. Happy birthday, French rugby legend Serge Blanco. Happy birthday, former New Zealand medium pacer Willie Watson and West Indian cricketing legend Clive Lloyd. I'm Jason Pine. Show producer Andy McDonald is here too. We are with you talking sport until three.
They fancy their chance at a turnover, but it doesn't matter. It's over. It's All Blacks heartbreak in the city of love. The old foes, South Africa, win the Rugby World Cup. 12-11 in the World Cup final.
Yeah, that was the last time the All Blacks played South Africa. The next one, just under 15 hours away in Johannesburg. We have a full live commentary for you right here on Newstalk ZB from just before 3 tomorrow morning. A decent chunk of the show this afternoon is dedicated to previewing this test match. All Blacks legend and the first skipper to lead the All Blacks to a test series victory in South Africa, Sean Fitzpatrick, standing by to chat with us. After one, we'll get a South African view from iconic Springboks winger Breyton Paulse. Our rugby editor, Elliot Smith, out of Joburg. The pre-game thoughts of key midfielder Geordie Barrett. And your thoughts, absolutely encouraged on this massive test for Razor's men. A bit later on, coaching guru Wayne Goldsmith with us with some thoughts on the possible effects of Leon McDonald's departure from the coaching group and how it might have been avoided. And is it absolutely necessary for members of a coaching team to actually be friends with one another? Or is conflict within a coaching group and challenging ideas and opinions actually a good thing? Other matters around today. Next month, New Zealand will compete at the FIFA Futsal World Cup for the very first time in Uzbekistan. Futsal Whites head coach Marvin Eakins is with us ahead of that. And we'll cross the Tasman. Adam Peacock having a well-earned break after working pretty much every day for the last, 3 months or so. He's on a couple of week break. Dan Lonergan, though, in Melbourne on Australian Sporting Matters. Heap of live sport to keep an eye on this afternoon, too. As you heard Elijah say in our sports news, the night action continues at the US Tennis Open, including Novak Djokovic's next match, which will be on Arthur Ashe Stadium. It should have started by now, but the previous game is going on a bit, as they tend to do at the US Tennis Open. So Novak Djokovic in action on Arthur Ashe Stadium this afternoon, New Zealand time, in the evening in New York. So we'll keep you across that. Closer to home, Farah Palmer Cup rugby. Taranaki and Otago just underway in New Plymouth. Hawke's Bay against Bay of Plenty, 2:05. And Waikato against Auckland, same time. And the Bunnings NPC, North Harbour against Counties Manukau. Albany, 2:05 this afternoon kickoff. And Taranaki hosting Otago in New Plymouth from 2:35. There are Heartland Championship matches as well this afternoon in Masterton, Ruatoria, Ashburton, Greymouth, Whanganui and Te Kawiti, which we will also keep you across. Join the show if you would like to. It is your show to get involved in if you so choose. Lines open all afternoon, 0800 80 10 80. You can send in your thoughts via text message to 9292. Or via email, jason@newstalkzb.co.nz. Just gone 10:30 midday.
The scoop from the track, field and the court on your home of sport, Weekend Sport with Jason Pine, Newstalk ZB.
Hugely anticipated test match tomorrow morning, Ellis Park in Johannesburg, All Blacks Springboks, 3 a.m. New Zealand time. To help preview this one, let's bring in one of our all-time greats. Sean Fitzpatrick played 128 games for the All Blacks, 62 of those as captain, 92 of the 128 games were test matches. He was the leader of the first All Blacks side to win a test series in South Africa in 1996.
Suzanne Brook dives it away to Frank Bunce. He skipped off his right foot. Caught from behind. No, skipped over that tackle. Big Frank Bunce to the 22. He sets it up nicely now for New Zealand. Right running ball. No, left running ball. The drop kick from Suzanne Brook. Suzanne Brook with a drop kick. He's over! Suzanne Brook, you are magic! It is over! It is over! The All Blacks have beaten South Africa by 33-26, two tests to nil, and our last rugby demon is slain. 75 long years after the first attempt back in 1928 and after four unsuccessful campaigns in 49, 1960, 1970 and 76, the men in the mightiest jersey of them all, the black with the silver fern, have lived the dream to win a test series in South Africa.
Sean Fitzpatrick is with us on Weekend Sports. Sean, that 1996 tour of South Africa, hearing the late Graham Moody's call of that iconic match at Loftus in Pretoria, where you secured the Test Series win in South Africa for the first time. When is that day rate among everything else that you achieved in the black jersey?
Well, it puts a little smile on my face, Jason, that's for sure. But good afternoon, good morning. Pleasure to be on your show. 1996 was an unbelievable experience. I just going to South Africa and being in South Africa now to watch the All Blacks play now, I'm just so excited because it's a big challenge. And, you know, John Hart and his management team and the 36 players, it was a big touring party in those days. To go to South Africa and win a series, it's as good as anything that I achieved. I always love telling the story of Don Clark, the great fullback, embraced me in the tunnel at Loftus Versfeld and said thank you. And he was crying, saying thank you so much for doing something that no other All Black team has done. He said, I can die a happy man. And that's what it meant to the past All Blacks. And that's why I'm so excited for Razor and this current team, that they've got a real opportunity over the next 2 weeks.
Those images at the end of you sprawled on the grass there, you'd made a tackle in the final play, the referee had blown it up, you'd won the game, you were just lying there and then got up on all fours, thumping your fist into the turf a couple of times. Those images are burnt into our memories. How empty was your tank at the end of that particular game?
It's a very intimidating place to go, Jason. And to go there, you have to go with an attitude that we're going to dominate. We're going to dominate the opposition because they like to dominate you. And the thing is, Jason, that we're very similar. We have huge respect for each other. We play a very similar game. And when they come to New Zealand, it's a huge challenge for them. But I think going to South Africa and going up to altitude, to the high veld, playing in Johannesburg, playing in Pretoria, it just adds that extra edge. And they are hugely passionate. And, you know, the All Blacks have been there for a week now, and they would have experienced what it's like to be in South Africa playing the Springboks off the field, because the fans are relentless. Day in, day out, morning, night time, they're telling you how the Springboks are going to beat you. And, you know, for me, I personally loved that because it's, you know, as New Zealanders, we traditionally like playing away from home as much as we love playing at home. And to go there and silence the crowd, and that's what this current team's going to have to do. It's going to have to take them on physically. You know, historically and currently, they're a big team. They're bigger than us. We know that. But it doesn't mean that we can't, you know, get on top of them. Because as soon as they get on top of you, and that's what they've been doing over the last few years, they are just bullying teams. You know, they bring on this reserve bench that just dominates a game after 60 minutes. So, you know, it's a big effort. And, you know, I look at the team that the All Blacks have picked. And it's a, you know, barring a couple of positions, it's a hugely experienced team. And to have Sam Kane there is another added bonus that I'm sure Razor, you know, had that in the plans to play this test match.
What about playing at altitude, Sean? How different was it playing in the likes of Johannesburg and Pretoria compared to matches in Cape Town and Durban, for example?
It burns you a bit, and it just, you know, I think this current team is, you know, admittedly they're not playing Super Rugby over there, like they had been in the past. But most of this team would have experienced playing at altitude. And, you know, they've been there over 7 days now. And I think that's the sort of the number that, you know, you sort of acclimatise to the altitude. And, you know, it hurts. But that's all part of the challenge. And you just got to realise that it's the same for them. You know, a lot of those players, a lot of them come from Cape Town or Durban. So, you know, it's an even playing field. And, you know, you can't use that as an excuse. You know, we've got a very good bench. So I'm very relaxed playing at altitude. And Ellis Park is, and I still like to call it Ellis Park, because that's what is historically named. And it's a cauldron. You know, there's only 62,000 people. It feels as though there's 100,000 people in there. And that's intimidating. So you've got to deal with that. And you know, as I'm sure Ray's is telling them, you've got to embrace the challenge, and do not let them get on top.
How have you rated the first five All Blacks tests of 2024?
We've got to realise that, you know, we work in cycles now, Jason. This is a 4-year cycle. You know, you don't replace players like Retallick, Whitelock, you know, very easily. And it's going to take time. And I think they've done really well. You know, they did well against the English. That English team is a very, very good team. So they did well against them. And then, you know, the Argentinian series, that you know, there was a bit of a learning going on there in that first test, because that Argentinian team, as we saw, is a very good team. They, unfortunately for them, they couldn't back it up, you know, 7 days later. But it's all part of the learning process, and that's what's so good about this, you know, this time away for the All Blacks being in South Africa. You know, you get two weeks or 3 weeks together in a place like South Africa, it's going to be a learning for a number of these players. But you go through this All Black team, there's a lot of experience there that will help the Damien McKenzies, the Ethan Blackadders of the world, the Taupo Vies, the Tamatu Williams. That will help them grow as players, and they'll get better. And this is the biggest challenge they would have faced a number of these players, you know, if not just this year. Ever.
One thing we always expect and know we're going to get from a test against South Africa is physicality. They're going to come in, as you've outlined, with their big, big men with a real physicality. How important is it to match them in that area and win that battle and the set piece battle when you play against the Springboks?
The big thing that I've loved over the last sort of 2 or 3 years is the development of our front row in terms of the props, and to have Cody Taylor in the middle, but to have Lomax and you know, Tamatu Williams, they are going to be the core to our success on Saturday without question. And that's, you know, you go back to what it was like for me playing against them. You know, Ollie Brown, Craig Dowd, Richard Lowe. It was up to us, you know, to take them on physically. And this is, as you've just said, this is a very good South African team. You know, and Rassie Erasmus, he'll have some tricks up his sleeve, I'm sure. But you saw, probably a good example, I'm sure Razor will be talking about this in terms of the current international teams, what Ireland did to South Africa in the summer in June this year, when they went down there, you know, lost the first test and then came back and just physically dominated the South Africans. And they came out with one of the great wins of the history of Irish rugby.
Disruption, of course, in the All Blacks camp before they flew out with the departure from the coaching group of Leon McDonald. What effect, if any, do you expect that to have on the coaches and on the players?
I'm sure that they would have maybe been aware of what was going on, would have been explained to them, and just get on with it. You know, it's a very new coaching group anyway, Jason. So I don't think it will have an effect. Obviously, there will be, you know, some of the players will be, you know, asking questions, but, you know, it's their job to play, not to get involved in the politics of the game. And we need everyone totally focused. And I'm sure that, you know, I'm sure with the experience, you know, having, you know, Sam Kane there and and Scott Barrett as captain. And then a lot of players coming back in too will make a big difference.
Just back to the South African side, I've heard it suggested by a number of people that this is a better South African side than the one that won the World Cup last year. What's your assessment of where they're at the moment?
I think they're definitely more confident, without question. They're growing in confidence, and that's, I take my hat off to them, you know, to win the World Cup and then say the following day we're going to win the next World Cup. You know, it's very much like the All Blacks, you know, in 2015. So, you know, they're getting better, superbly coached, and they've grown that. They've tapped into a few other coaches around the world and one of ours. But he is relentless in terms of trying to get better. You know, the way we did it yesterday is not good enough to win today. And that's I imagine, one of his catchphrases and the challenge he lays down to his coaches and the players. And you look at those players, they don't look tired. They're just growing as people, and they've got a great team ethos. And yeah, I think I agree with you. I think they are better than what they were, you know, a year ago.
All right, so you'll be there at Ellis Park among the 65,000 South Africans. You'll be a bit of a lone voice, or maybe one of a few. What will you be looking for, Sean, in the first, I don't know, 10 or 15 minutes to indicate that the All Blacks are well and truly in this? What are you hoping to see from them early on?
You know, the first sort of 10 minutes, it'll just be electric. And, you know, if we can limit our mistakes, don't give away penalties. You just can't afford to. You give away a penalty on your 22, you know, they're going to kick the ball 70 metres down the field just with the altitude, and their line out's very strong. So we've just got to make sure we limit the mistakes. We have to have at least parity at scrum and line out time. So we're comfortable kicking the ball out. We don't want them comfortable kicking the ball out knowing that they're going to challenge our line out. So we just need to, you know, make sure that we're in the game until the last minute. And that's, you know, you look back to 96, they do not go away. They keep knocking at the door, and, you know, eventually sometimes they knock the door down. I'm feeling very comfortable. I love the look of the current team, the team he's named to play this game. I'd love them to do the job, and then we can go down to sea level and have a crack at a series one.
Indeed. Sean, so great to get the chance to catch up. Enjoy the occasion that will be, as you say, absolutely electric there at Ellis Park in Johannesburg. Really appreciate you joining us here in New Zealand across News Talk ZB.
Thanks, Jason.
Thanks, Sean. Sean Fitzpatrick there, one of the great All Blacks captains, and a real pioneer. He kind of went across from the amateur game to the professional game, didn't he? And was one of the trailblazers in that space. And those images from 1996, just forever iconic. Keen to get your thoughts now. 0800 80 10 80. Anything you want to pick up on from what you heard there from Sean Fitzpatrick, or just the thoughts really which have been most prominent in your head as you've been thinking across the week about this test match? How confident, how optimistic, or maybe pessimistic you are? Your main areas of concern? Any players who you think are particularly important to the All Blacks' chances of winning, or just an aspect of the match you want to pick up on or you'll be looking out for? 0800 80 10 80. Outside of Rugby World Cups, I cannot remember looking forward to an All Blacks test match as much as I'm looking forward to this one. And while Bledisloe Cup test matches still have plenty of attraction and intrigue, you know, we're playing our big brother from across the Tasman, the Wallabies' inability to make that an actual contest in the last 20 years has meant the test matches against South Africa have well and truly become our yardstick. If we want to know how good we are, let's play South Africa in South Africa and find out. The last time we played them, of course, was the one-point loss in the World Cup final, so there are some demons to be buried there. And while there has been a period of adjustment under Scott Robertson, I don't think there's any argument about that. The Springboks have, as I mentioned to Sean Fitzpatrick, if anything, gotten better in 2024. They split their series with Ireland, then they swatted the Wallabies aside with very little problem. So they are the standard setters. They're the number one side in the world for a reason. Just before we go to the lines, there is something a bit special, isn't there, about getting up in the middle of the night to watch the All Blacks? Bit of a throwback to the old days of Northern Hemisphere tours. Games were played in the wee hours of our morning. We'd get up with a Milo, a couple of chocolate bickies to watch grainy footage from half a world away, or in the generation before that, to crowd around the radio to follow the men in black from afar. Just set the alarm for this one. Going to be a doozy.
Weekend Sport.
0800 80 10 80 12 27. Ivor, thanks for holding. How are you?
Good, I'll just take your speaker. Yeah, good, thanks. Yeah. And, I've forgotten your name.
My name's Jason. Ivor, good to have you with us.
Jason. Yeah. What did you say?
No, it's good to have you with us. What's on your mind?
Good. Thanks. I was just thinking about this game, and I reckon I know the South Africans are the definite favourites for the game, but I do think at the end of this game, actually, the New Zealanders will come up trumps.
What gives you the confidence, Ivor? What is it that gives you that confidence that they can get the job done?
Oh, you know the All Blacks over the years. I've had they had Jonah Lomu, and he just used to run from one end of the field to the other with the rugby ball on his arm, and there'd be four or five guys running, jumping, skipping at him, and he just went like a steam train.
Yeah, I guess though you'll remember. I remember the 1995 World Cup final when, you know, he'd been so good up till then. And then they kind of worked him out, didn't they? They got James Small, the little, by comparison, winger, to sort of jump on him like a little sort of a junkyard dog. And then the big forwards would arrive. And, yeah, Jonah didn't get a try in that game. No one for the All Blacks got a try in that game. In fact, no one got a try in that game. It was 15-12, all kicks.
Inga the winger?
Inga the winger is another one. I feel like we're throwing back a bit, Ivor. We need to look at let's look at the current guys. Will Jordan, Caleb Clark on the wings. Still a pretty potent combination. Ivor, it's good to chat to you, mate. Thanks for calling in. I believe Ivor might have called in from somewhere in Asia. Good to chat to you, mate. Thanks for taking the time to pick up the phone. George, how are you feeling about this?
Yeah, I'm good, thanks. Piney, how are you?
I'm good, George. I'm good. Are you confident?
Hey, I am. I don't necessarily want to relitigate last week's discussion on the coaches too much, but I just had a quick comment on the coaching really quickly before we put it to bed. I thought that the chat on the talkback last week was a bit granular as to trying to figure out why he left. The only thing I sort of had around it was I was a bit worried who the person was. You know, Leo McDonald was arguably the only coach in the environment who was external to the Crusaders setup, and it just feels a little bit like maybe he was, you know, the first person to challenge Razor in some of his thinking, and is this a reflection on how open to feedback or challenging conversations Razor is? Because, you know, there's a fine balance between being told what you want to hear from a coach versus, you know, healthy levels of challenge. And I just wonder if Razor's pushed back a bit too much quite quickly.
Interesting point you make, George. I wonder what you do, if you've got the chance to listen after two. Wayne Goldsmith, our coaching guru, is on that very topic, challenging coaches within the environment. If you can't listen, you might be able to listen back or find it somewhere. But it's an interesting point. Jason Holland, of course, also outside that Crusaders environment, so he's in there too. But, yeah, no, we haven't heard from Leon, which is, I guess, going to have to wait. Again, we've extended the invitation to him to join us, and eventually I'm sure he'll tell his side of the story. But yeah, I guess they carry on, they absorb responsibility among the rest of them, and let's see how they go tomorrow morning, whether it has any effect. It'll be hard to tell, you know, whether it's had any quantifiable effect. We'll probably just have to make our own assumptions.
Yeah. The only other quick one, I wondered if it was a question to Chris Lindrum or someone else there around, what's Wayne Smith's involvement through the process been? Because, you know, I understood Wayne Smith joined the environment more from a coaching, mentoring point of view. I thought something like this, a mediation of sorts, would have been right up his alley in terms of his experience. You know, when he joined the All Blacks in 2004, I think, with Graham Henry, he was close to walking out in that year, if I remember correctly. And, you know, Steve Hansen would have been a challenging assistant coach. I thought this would be where Wayne Smith would earn his bread and butter. So it would be interesting to get a comment from those in the know as to how involved Wayne Smith's been through through the process of Leon departing.
Yeah, I read Gregor Paul in the Herald yesterday, and his assessment or his fact-finding on that had been that there hadn't been any, that this wasn't something that Wayne Smith got involved in a mediation sense or anything like that. So the answer, I think, is that he wasn't involved. That was what I read from Gregor Paul in the Herald yesterday.
No problems. Go the All Blacks.
Go the ABs, George. Good on you, mate. Drive safe. Always good to chat to you. 28 away from 1. 0800 80 1080 is our number if you want to jump aboard. 9292 on text. But the best way to get your point across is on the phone. One spare line there if you want to use it. We're back after this on Weekend Sport.
Crunch, hold, engage. Weekend Sport with Jason Pine and GJ Gardner-Holmes. New Zealand's most trusted home builder. News Talk ZB.
5-1. Jared has reminded me, or pointed out to me, and I think I knew this, but I had to fact check it. Jonah never scored a try against South Africa in any test match. 12 times he played South Africa and didn't get a try. That's remarkable. Considering he scored 37 tries in 63 tests, the great, great man, didn't get a single one in 12 test matches against South Africa. Thanks, Jared. They clearly worked him out, not just in the 95 final, but overall. Hey, Matt, how are you? Just turn your radio down there, Matt. Otherwise, you'll hear two of me, mate. I think one's probably enough.
All right. Well done.
Good stuff, mate. What's on your mind?
Well, I think it's going to be really hard for the All Blacks, but I think there's key players that depends on how they perform. They're going to change the game. I think they're going to try to destroy McKenzie. I love McKenzie, but when... if they try to put him down, it's going to be trouble for us. And then Jordy Barrett's another player. I think he can make a difference.
But I agree on that.
Sam Kane also. If he's in a good mood, I think we have a chance. But that key players, if they're in a bad mood, I think it's going to be really tough.
I think Sam Kane's only got one mood when it comes to test matches, Matt. And I think it is just wholehearted commitment to the black jersey. There's been a lot of criticism of him, you know, around his captaincy and bits and pieces like that. But he honestly, he's one guy who hits and hits hard and pushes guys back, you know, past the game line. They've said that Dalton Papali'i's got a bit of an injury and Sam Kane's in there. I would have had Kane in there anyway for this one.
Yeah, I just said the wrong word. It's not a good mood. The mood is always the same. I think if they let him to show the other players, he can go forward and break the line, etc. I think that's the main thing that's going to change the game at the end.
Good man, Matt. Appreciate your thoughts, mate. Appreciate them very much. 0800 80 10 80. Corey asks, if we win both test matches, is that classed as a series win, our second one ever, or does it need to be three matches to be a series win? I think since the rugby championships come in, Corey, good question. I don't think there's such a thing as a series anymore against any of these sides. You could look at a series within the rugby championship and say, right, we play South Africa twice, so if we win them both, do we win that little mini series? But I think as far as test series against South Africa are concerned, if we look at 1996 as the first time we'd ever done that, yeah, it had to be a three match. And, you know, going back, we played four. In fact, we played four that year. The first of them, though, from memory, was a rugby championship test, which we also won. And then there were three more, which then constituted the series in South Africa. Because I remember looking at the 1996 results and saying, well, actually, we won three tests before the fourth, which we lost. But it was the fact that the first one didn't count as part of the series. It was a bit weird. It was a bit weird. But it was iconic. And just listening to Fitzy talk about it, how good was that? Hello, Phil.
Hey, how are you, Jason?
Great, thank you, Phil.
A couple of stories from 1956. I'm in my 70s now, so we just live on the past, you know.
Why not?
I was eight. I was eight in 1956. And all of our parents and a lot of them all come back from the war, and that was just rugby, racing, and beer. And, you know, I can still say all the names of that Springbok, Lochner, Strydom, Van Vollenhoffen. I know the whole team, you know, and it got into our DNA. But anyway, my father went to Pat's Town. He went to St. Pat's Town. And then when they split Silverstream, he went up to Silverstream. One of his good friends at St. Pat's Town was Winston McCarthy.
Oh, and, wow.
And anyway, they lost touch. He was 14 when they split. And Winston McCarthy stayed at St. Pat's Town. And then they met again 8 years later in Stellar Gate B. And so, you know, they renewed their friendship. But we lived in the hut, and Winston used to come out to our house, and all the war mates, Kevin Skinner, used to come out, and they'd all drink, and that, and then Winston McCarthy would get up on the old Bell radiogram and stand on the end of these lurid commentaries. It was hilarious, and I was only young. Yeah. But anyway, after the test, 60,000 people at Athletic Park, and I went to the New Zealand Universities game. And when it was announced that they were going to have a kickoff, Don Clark and Bob Scott, Bettoni, they were going to have a kickoff on the Sunday morning. Every kid in the Hutt Valley went to the Bettoni Rec and they rally 24s, and it was a leather ball, wet. It was like a brick, and they started on the 25 in those days, and they went backwards, 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 and they matched each other for about five or six shots, and then Bob Scott said, "Okay, bare feet." And he kicked the ball on the halfway. He kicked the ball on halfway with bare feet and got it over. Don Clark couldn't match that. But anyway, that was a couple of things. But I met Kevin Skinner. I didn't realise the importance, but then I refereed for a lot of years after that. And we found out a few things. The Springboks arrived with shoulder pads in that first test where they crunched us. And the second test, referees can only administer law, and there was no law for shoulder pads, but there was no law against it.
So they wore shoulder pads, and are you talking about test at Athletic Park?
Yeah, leather shoulder pads. And
wow.
We found out later that they'd actually laced two strips of bamboo into the shoulder pads, and that's why they crunched us. And anyway, I bumped into Kevin Skinner way back in the 80s. He came out and talked to us, and I said, "Is it true what happened at halftime?" He said, "What do you mean?" And I said, "That you went into their dressing room." He said, "Oh, yeah." He said, "The other prop left concussed," because he was a heavyweight boxing champ up to 1953, Kevin Skinner, and then he never played a test match, and they brought him back for the 56 test. The other guy left concussed halfway through that game, and he went out to the dressing room and dropped the other guy under Athletic Park.
I love it. Oh, I love
all
it, Phil.
Those stories come out, you know.
Yeah.
So there you go.
Good on you, mate. Hey, great to get your reminiscing, mate. GP, you got a brilliant memory of 1956. What's that? 44 cents. That's 68 years ago now. Crikey. Good on you, Phil. Brilliant stuff. Yeah, that was a real test series, wasn't it? That 1950. I was just looking at that as you were talking to me. Then I was just looking up the scores in 1956. 10-6 to the All Blacks in Dunedin. 8-3 to South Africa in Wellington. 17-10. Quite high scoring in Christchurch. And then 11-5 to the All Blacks in Auckland for a 3-1 series win, Phil. I'm sure you knew all those scores. Those are real rugby scores, aren't they? None of this 42-38 stuff. 17 away from one. We'll get a breakaway, come back with more after this. 0800 80 10 80 if you want to jump aboard.
You be the TMO. Have your say on 0800 80 10 80. Weekend Sport with Jason Fine and GJ Gardner-Holmes. New Zealand's most trusted home builder. News Talk ZB.
14 to 1 on text. Matt asks, Jason, did Norm Hewitt, who passed away recently, ever play against South Africa? A good question, Matt. Just the once. You remember, of course, that those were the days when we didn't really roll the subs. And so we had Sean Fitzpatrick on before. Norm Hewitt had to sit on the bench and watch Sean Fitzpatrick play those 92 test matches and very rarely got a chance. Only 9 test matches Norm Hewitt played. One of those was against South Africa off the bench in 1997 for a 35-32 win. In fact, Norm Hewitt was never on a losing All Black side in a test match. Thanks for the question, Matt. Carlos, were you there in 1996?
Yes, I was, Piney. Yes, I was fortunate enough. I went on the full tour. It was the old, through the old Sunday news. But anyway, long story short, yeah, went on the full tour. I was fortunate enough to be with Sir Needle, Fred Allen, and went there. And we went, it was after Jeff Wilson got the ball knocked out of his hand from Gregan, because it was part of the anyway, because, and you're exactly right what you said earlier, Piney. Cape Town was the first one, and we won there. And then they had a week's rest. So we went and watched Australia and Bloemfontein versus South Africa. And then, of course, the tour started after that. We played, I think it was Boland from memory first, Piney. But anyway, went through all of that. She had a midweek game, and, of course, they took, well, Sean Fitzpatrick, you know, mentioned earlier, 36 players, which was they had to. And Hardy had that right from the word go, because they basically had two teams, one midweek, one for the main games. But people crossed over, like Aussie and all of that, you know, Glenn Osborne. But she was a beaut. Anyway, 90 years. So I happened to be there, and fortunate enough, Mr. Shelford bought a tour group over as well, and he was for the Kings Park for the first of the official tests. And anyway, I was sitting there in the stands next to a couple of people away. Was a unbeaten coach and an unbeaten bloody captain. They had tears in my eyes, and in Victoria. Yeah, it was just
how
amazing.
Good.
And it was, Piney. It really was. Another thing, sorry, just the gentleman who was touching on shoulder pads. There was a guy from the All Blacks who wore them, and as well, his name was Tiny White, and he said he wore them to protect the opposition when he tackled them.
It was more like cushioning, was it, for the opponents rather than any weaponry for himself?
Correct, and that was Tiny White, and funny. But anyway, more importantly, go to the ABs tonight. The only one we did lose was in Ellis Park, the final one, but I don't think it mattered too much. The boys were celebrating pretty well.
Oh, I bet they were.
After a series win.
I bet you were in the stands as well, Carlos. Good on you, mate. What a story. Terrific. And what company to be in as well, as you were watching from high up there in at Loftus. Even hearing Sean Fitzpatrick say that once, when they won that game, Don Clark, the aforementioned Don Clark, gave him a hug and said, thank you. Thank you for doing something we weren't able to do. Yeah, showed just how much it meant. Good on you, Carlos. Appreciate your call as always. Hello, Mark.
Good afternoon, buddy. Very quietly confident. I'm about to go down to the tab and put a lazy hundry on the All Blacks. But maybe a piece of useless trivia for you and the listeners. The difference in altitude between Eden Park and Ellis Park. If you put around about 5.5 sky towers together end on end, there's the difference in altitude. There ain't much oxygen up there, is there?
No. No, and I interesting to hear from Mark, interesting to hear from Sean Fitzpatrick that it burns most early on in the game. But then you're kind of acclimatised. But if you've been there for a week, then I presume anyway that you acclimatise yourself. That's the reason they get over there for a week or so.
Yeah. Well, see, the Sky Tower's 328.
Joburg, so five of those.
Joburg 1760. So there's a big difference in there in the altitude.
Big difference. Big difference, Mark. Yeah, five Sky Towers. I'll think about that as I watch them at Ellis Park. Talking to Elliot Smith after 1 o'clock, I heard him on Gold Sport earlier this week saying that he'd got a nosebleed. He's never been to Joburg before. And walking around, he just got the altitude nosebleed, which is apparently quite common. That, you know, you just, I don't know what causes it. Presumably the altitude does something to your nasal passages, I don't know. But, you know, he got a couple of nosebleeds, or at least one anyway. And he also said that one of the players did. I guess when they're, like if they're doing scrum practice, wouldn't matter what altitude you're at, that'd burst a couple of blood vessels, wouldn't it? Our number's 0800 80 10 80. Lance says Tiny Hill wore the leather shoulder pads to protect the opposition from his bony shoulders, not Tiny White. He still smashed them in tackles even with the pads. I think that shows remarkable care for your fellow man. To think to yourself, right, I've got very bony shoulders, and if I'm hitting these opponents with those bony shoulders, they might come out second best. So what I'll do is I'll pad my shoulders so that I don't hurt them so much. I think that shows remarkable empathy for an opponent who you're trying to succumb. 8-1, News Talk ZB, back after this.
Breaking down the Hail Marys and the epic fails. Weekend Sport with Jason Pine, Newstalk, ZB.
5-1. Here's All Blacks captain Scott Barrett talking about playing at altitude.
Yeah, I think this week, particularly Tuesday training, we've certainly felt it, and as the week's gone on, our preparation's improved, and we've adapted to the conditions, and I think it's the same for both teams. So, you know, we'll look to play for 80 minutes and, take the Springboks deep.
And anything personal in this for any of the players who were involved in the one-point loss in the Rugby World Cup final to the same opposition?
I can't change anything that happened from the final. Probably won't ever get over that. I think it's about this group turning up tomorrow night and... Ellis Park against the Springboks. No other test like it, and that's what we're excited about.
That is the voice of Scott Barrett, back after a couple of tests off with that hand injury. On text, Piney, the thing that bothers me about the Springbok team is the Tony Brown factor. Rassie has brought him in to bring the box lethal wingers into play more so than in the past. Yeah, good point. Breyton Paulse, actually, after 1 o'clock, I'll ask him about Tony Brown's influence on this team in terms of a more expansive style of play. I'll be up with Marmite and cheese toasties at 3, says Rob. Good on you, Rob. Always got to have a plan for nutrition. Jim says, I'm confident. This feels very much like the Irish test at the Rugby World Cup. A lot of payback owed and redemption for the entire team, but especially Sam Kane. I've got the All Blacks by 10, says Jim. Good on you, Jim. The All Blacks are not favourites of the TAB, but if you want them by 13 and over, $6, if you're that confident. Breyton Paulse, iconic Springboks winger, with us after 1.
The only place to discuss the biggest sports issues on and off the field. It's all on Weekend Sport with Jason Pine, on your home of sport. Newstalk ZB.
107. Welcome into Weekend Sport. We're here till 3. I'm Jason Pine. Andy McDonald is executive producer of the show. We're talking rugby mainly today. Regular listeners to ZB will know we're also on the air on Sundays between midday and 3. So tomorrow, I would imagine that we will talk mainly about what happens at Ellis Park tomorrow morning at 3 o'clock. We've got a full commentary for you here on News Talk ZB. Text through from Char. Piney, I remember the fourth test of the 1970 series in South Africa. Colin Meads played with a broken arm. Jazz Muller and Keith Murdoch were our props. It was the rucking days, and a South African forward got caught over the ball. Well, did our front row give him a working over? He was spat out the back. Jazz Muller, it says, was famous for cutting his hedge with a lawnmower. Is that right? Got the lawnmower up to cut his hedge. That's the way to build upper body strength, isn't it? Thank you for your text, Cha. This hour, we're going to continue our build-up to this test match shortly with Breyton Paulse out of South Africa. Elliot Smith also standing by for a chat. And across to Australia, Adam Peacock's away for a couple of weeks. In his place, Dan Lonergan going to join us with some Australian sporting musings. Speaking of which, there's an Australian on Arthur Ashe Stadium at the moment at Flushing Meadows, taking on Novak Djokovic at the US Open. Alexei Popperin, he's serving at 3-4 down, and with the advantage, in fact, he's just closed out the eighth game of the first set, so 4-all on serve, Novak Djokovic and Alexei Popperin in their match. So we'll talk a bit of tennis, some other Australian sporting matters as well. Your calls and correspondence continue to be welcomed. 0800 80 10 80 is our phone number. 9292 is our text line. jason@newstalkzb.co.nz if you would like to send a text. Let's get a South African view, though, on this test match from an absolute Springboks legend. Exceptional wing Breyton Paulse played 64 test matches for the Springboks between 1999 and 2007. Went to the 1999 and 2003 Rugby World Cups. His lightning pace and acute game awareness saw him become one of the most prolific try scorers in the modern era. 26 tries across his 64 test matches, including this one against the All Blacks in a 40-26 win at Ellis Park in 2004.
Tutupo Mertens. Milianina is well tackled there, well read there by Breyton Paulse. Kunradi, and Monty's got it. Can Monty beat Arlett? He feeds on the inside.
Yeah, famous try by Paulse in a victory at Ellis Park. He also scored 38 tries in 81 games for his beloved Stormers. Following his playing career, he became a popular commentator, presenter and analyst. Breyton Paulse is with us. How are you, mate?
Thanks for having me, Jace. I tell you what, the excitement in South Africa at the moment, it's unreal. I wish you could be here to experience what we experience at the moment. It feels like building up to the World Cup final of last year, and obviously we all know what happened, but there's huge excitement. But I can tell you one thing, that there's no underestimating from the Springboks, for the All Blacks. I mean, we all know that even though the All Blacks haven't hit their straps, in my opinion, I think there's lots of room for improvement. There's mutual respect, and there's a quiet sort of nervousness amongst the fans especially. So I tell you what, even me, I'm a little bit nervous. When the Springboks go in as favourites, we don't like that. We like to be the underdogs in any kind of game.
Well, it's a rare feeling, as you know, for the All Blacks, because they more often than not are favourites. But like, I think everybody can see what happened in the Rugby World Cup final and can see what's happened in 2024. Brayton, I'd be interested in your view on the Springboks of 2024. I've heard it suggested they're a better team than the one that won the Rugby World Cup. What's your assessment on that?
Yes, they are, and purely because you guys borrowed us Tony Brown. He's been doing some great work behind the scenes. And let me tell you, when you look at stats, and obviously when we have to prepare for rugby games, you look at kind of stats, not that it will make a big difference, but one stat that's quite remarkable is the amount of passing that the Springboks have been doing compared to previous years. And I think they kind of earn the respect, and that's why another masterstroke by Rusty Erasmus, bringing in Tony Brown, purely for the attacking game for the Springboks, which has been lacking. If you have the likes of Cheslin Kolbe, Makazole Mapimpi, Kirtley Aronson, you want to get the ball into those fellows' hands. They do create danger. They do create chaos. And that's what you want all the time. But in saying that, the World Cup, we won it because we are so good in our defensive system, and we pressurize teams, and we are so well-conditioned. The last 10 minutes, the boys go up another notch, and other teams sort of crack, if I can put it that way. So the attacking flair of what Tony Brown has brought to this team, they're not there yet. It's work in progress, but they don't mind having a go when it's on. Like the All Blacks, of 10 years ago, when they were unstoppable and throwing the ball around, when they really soften up the guys up front.
One thing that we know we're always going to get from South African sides is physicality. And you've talked there about the perhaps more expansive attacking game, but is the physicality of the Springboks, forward pack in particular, still at the heart of what they do?
Yes, that's their core, and that's what they believe in. I think that's the uniqueness of any South African team, whether you're playing in the lower divisions or whether you play at URC level or Super Rugby level. South African teams, first and foremost, the guys want to scrum, they want to rock, they want to maul, they want to bully people. So that will never go away. But now you're adding the likes of Jesse Creel, Damien Dialende, Apalele Fassi, Aronson and Colbys. Those guys want to run the ball. And it must be frustrating for them at times just to chase balls, and they're doing it so well. But now, when it's on, they will give a call from the outside, and the ball will go to the wingers. Their first try of Apalele Fassi against the Australian team, I was actually in studio that day, and we analysed it. And back in the day, or last year, when they turn over ball, they will kick it away. Now, it's going through the hands, from props, from locks, to the wingers, and to the outside channel. So that is quite exciting from a South African perspective, but they're not there yet. They know they will need to work at what Tony Brown, it'll probably take a year for them to get the balance right. I think it's all about the balance. And people like this team because now, you know, I always say it's the chairman of the little men. Little guys also get opportunities like Kirtley Aronson and Cheslin Kolbe. So that's fantastic. These guys are absolute heroes at the moment in South Africa.
Afolele Fassi is an interesting one. Has he now gone past Willie LaRue as the first choice fullback?
Yeah, I wouldn't say that as yet. If you look again at his stats, you will see he was first in terms of line breaks, meters made, all that beautiful stuff. But I think he's worked on his aerial skills. He worked on little sort of shortcomings that the coaching staff required of him. And I think in a difficult season for him at the Sharks, the Sharks had so many Springboks, but they kept losing in URC. They were our worst team, the biggest budget. It didn't win for them. So Apalele Fassi was the one shining light in the Sharks team. And I think Rusty Erasmus, when a player is so good, when he is in so much good form, they tend to stick with him. The same like Sasha Feinberg and Gomo Zulu. I tell you what, Jace, I'm just surprised. I had a chat to his dad the other day. I can't believe how calm that young man is. He's absolutely calm. It's almost like he's been waiting for this moment and he belongs there. He's really taken like a duck to water. And it's quite incredible to see when young players come into the side, they just enjoy the environment and they thrive under those pressure situation, because as you know, like New Zealand, South African fans are ruthless. You know, if you don't perform, they want you out. But at the moment, we're going through a good time, and it's been like that for the last 5-6 years, and people just love it. There's no single ticket, Jace. I tell you, people, mates of mine are still phoning me. I'm getting so upset. There's no single ticket. And I tell you what, even next week, if South Africa had two stadiums, or there was a stadium that could take 150,000 people, it would have been sold out. Cape Town also is waiting in the wings, but this week it's going to be incredible. The weather today is a bit chilly, but tomorrow should be fine, and altitude is going to play a role. We're all so excited. I hope you guys too.
Oh, we really are, and I can sense it in your voice, Breyton. And I want to ask you about the altitude thing, because of course you were based mainly in Cape Town with the Stormers during your career. When you had to go to altitude, to Pretoria, to Joburg, did you feel the effects of it?
Yes. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. It does play a role. But we're living in modern times, and science plays a big role these days. We look at, I was covering the URC final when the Blue Bulls played the Glasgow Warriors. And let me tell you, altitude didn't play a role either. In fact, it was reverse. The last 20 minutes, Glasgow were out of the game. They upped the speed and they took the game away from the Bulls, and they ultimately won the game. Coming back to 2 years ago, we came from Mbombela, where the box were in control. They beat your blokes, kind of not easily, but they were in control for the whole game. We went to Ellis Park. You guys came, played a high tempo, high paced game, and I feel if the All Blacks do have a chance in beating the box, they need to start running from the beginning and get that out of your system. When we used to play the Lions at Ellis Park, we used to go very hard the first 15 minutes in terms of throwing the ball around. So you can get that, what we call that second wind. And for me, that is key for the All Blacks. And I know Razor, I've got so much respect for him, played against him many a time. You know, and I do feel he's a really credible coach. And he's still trying to find his feet. But he came to South Africa a lot, and he played there a lot. He coached there a lot. He won there a lot. He had success there a lot. So for me, if the All Blacks stand a chance, they need to go hard that first 20 minutes. Just throw the ball around and see what the box can do in countering that.
As a Springboks player, and now as a Springboks fan, and speaking for all Springboks fans, I guess, Breyton, is there still something special about the black jersey, about playing against the All Blacks? Was there for you when you were a Springboks player?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Still. I know New Zealand's going through a bit of a rough patch, and we, as Springbok players and ex-Springbok players, we can never write them off. That is the talk from, you know, ex-Springboks and analysts and guys who's actually been there. A wounded All Black is like a wounded Springbok. When those guys are angry, they come at you with desperation, and that means they have a chance. So, you know, even when I became a Springbok, I look at the calendar, I'm like, okay, when am I playing the All Blacks? You know, you can't kind of, we can't wait to play the All Blacks. And I'm sure the same for the All Blacks. So the rivalry is back to where it was supposed to be, like, you know, like the last 100 years. And I think that's wonderful. And because the All Blacks, to a certain extent, are building in a sort of phase where they're not sure what to do week in and week out, but we could not underestimate the All Black team. The respect is absolutely insane. And I think from a South African perspective, you know, people also, I mean, Cape Town, I tell you, you guys got so many fans in Cape Town, for instance. So the All Blacks will feel they played home next week. So it shows you that mutual respect is there, and we love to see it.
Yeah, we love to see it as well, Breyton. I've just so enjoyed chatting to you and getting a sense of the occasion over there. We're very envious on this side of the world that we can't get up close and personal, but we'll be watching from afar and really curious to see what happens. Really appreciate you taking the time to join us across New Zealand today.
Thank you, Jace, and enjoy the game.
You enjoy the game too, Breyton. Breyton Paulse, what a top man. Jeez, you can just feel the excitement, can't you? Texts are here. I'm getting goosebumps just listening to this chat. I am too. Let's open the lines again. 0800 80 1080. If you couldn't get through before 1, a chance to make a point now. Texts are here. The absolute joy of watching the All Blacks beat South Africa 35-32 at the Ellis Park Cauldron in 1997. Hostile big time. The overriding memory was Frank Bunce running towards me to score one of his two tries. I remember that test match, or I remember the second of Frank Bunce's tries. I'm pretty sure this is the game that you're talking about here. He got it on about halfway, and he set off, and he had, you know, plenty of defenders to beat. And he had the likes of Christian Cullen, and Josh Kronfeld inevitably was on his shoulder, and Tane Randall was there or thereabouts as well, but he just kept going and going and going. And he beat the last two defenders on the line and scored a terrific try. 35-32, Ellis Park, 1997. Terrific. Ellis Park, there's been a lot of talk about the vociferous home support, playing at altitude, but we actually do okay in Joburg. Although I had a check, and games there in recent times have been pretty few and far between. In fact, this is only the fifth game at Ellis Park between the All Blacks and the Springboks since 2004. There was the test 2 years ago. The last time we were there was 2 years ago. Remember when the All Blacks basically saved Ian Foster's job, scoring a couple of late tries. They won 35-23. The time before that, 2015, a 27-20 victory ahead of the Rugby World Cup that year, which of course we also won, beating South Africa in the semi-finals. The time before that was 2014. Replacement first five, Pat Lambie, landing a 52-metre penalty with a minute to go to give South Africa a 27-25 win. That ended a 22-game unbeaten run. And we won there in 2013, 38-27, scoring five tries. So that's three wins in the last four. We shouldn't fear the venue, I don't reckon, as much as perhaps has been made out. 0800 80 10 80 is our number, 9292 if you would prefer to send a text. Goose is with us. Have you been to Ellis Park?
No, Piney, I definitely haven't. Not been to South Africa at all. It's a place I would most definitely like to watch a game of footy. Can't have been the other one.
Absolutely. How are you feeling about tomorrow morning, mate?
Well, we definitely deserve to be underdogs and going into Ellis Park. Altitude, everybody talks about altitude, but I don't think it really makes any difference whatsoever. They suffer the same. Nobody that lives up there, the Springboks don't live up there, so they suffer the same physical dramas adapting to the lack of oxygen as we do, so it doesn't really make any difference. At Ellis Park, as you say, we do fairly well there. It's a scene of our worst ever win, with the All Blacks coming back from South Africa and the win we had there that saved Foster's job. If we hadn't won that game, I'm picking the coaching team that we'd have going over there would be World Cup winners, and it'd be Razor and Tony Brown, which is who he was after in the first place when they decided to go with Foster. So I think, sadly, Razor is red and black as I see out of my one eye. I'm still I'm a Razor fan, but I think it's a pretty gutless team naming that he's come up with. He's gone back to some players that we've had no end of trouble with. Enrico Ioane in the midfield's a classic example of a guy that just shouldn't be in the 23 at all. We've got an advantage in that Papali'i was injured, so he couldn't pick him. I wouldn't have gone the way that he's gone. I would have probably had Ethan and Jacobson over Sam, but Sam's probably got something to prove. So we'll give him a chance, and with a bit of luck, would be one of his final tests. I don't think we've got a great deal of hope if you look at it on paper. But it's the All Blacks against South Africa, and realistically going in, the TAB odds are way too out of whack for the reality of an All Blacks South African test match, no matter how poor we are at the moment.
Yeah, I wouldn't say I'm worried, but I'm very interested in the way Tony Brown has influenced the South African side. Goose, I'm sure you've seen it as well. As Breyton Paulse said, you know, they've always been a very physical side. It doesn't take a brain surgeon to work that out. But I just think he's unlocked a lot more potential in the back line, even in the games I've seen this year against good opposition like Ireland. His fingerprints are on this team already, Tony Brown.
Yeah, 100%. Fine. It sticks out like the proverbial dogs, but If we had had him, we'd be doing, I suspect we'd be doing the same sorts of things, as in running it like we used to, rather than this absolutely demented halfback 10 or 12. If it gets back as far as Bowden, doesn't matter who it is, just hoof it downfield and let's have a go at a line out or an up and under. That's an absolute waste of time because we're so inaccurate. It's just a really poor game plan, or it's the skill level we've got. I mean, Razor's been handed the worst crop of international players in the professional era for effectively two cycles under Hanson and Foster. We were stuck with this 10/15 palaver where we now don't have an international quality 10 available in the country. The best hope we've got is that Razor throws some time into Plummer. The only real hope we've got is that NZR bites the bullet, realises what flogs they were, and buys Richie back. So, we're in trouble for a number of years to come, no matter how good Razor is.
Goose, nothing if not articulate in your views, mate. Always good to chat to you. Drive safe. 0800 80 1080 126. Back with more after this. In fact, just before we go to a break, I want to update you on the tennis, because Alexei Poprin has won the first set against Novak Djokovic, 6-4. So the Australian 28th seed, a set to the good over Novak Djokovic. We will keep eyes on that. Djokovic has won the first game of the second set on his serve. So Poprin is set to love ahead and love one behind on serve in the second at Arthur Ashe. 127, back after this.
It's more than just a game. Weekend Sport with Jason Pine and GJ Gardner Holmes, New Zealand's most trusted home builder. News Talk ZB.
129, Brendan asks, was it Ellis Park where Andrew Mertens gave them the one finger salute? No, that was in Loftus in Pretoria, Brendan, playing for the Crusaders against the Bulls. Another memorable moment. Paul says, we may feel like the underdog, but my South African colleague at work fears the All Blacks. So it's even Stevens. Bring it on. Good on you, Paul. Apata Hama, how would you describe your levels of optimism?
Low, Piney, low. I'm honest.
Low? Oh, dear.
But, you know, like, bro, you've talked to me many times. Being a Wellington, New Zealand cricket fan over all the years, you know, I'm just a pessimist. I've been to Ellis Park too, Piney. I think it was Spain 2, Honduras 0. And David Villa missed a penalty. But, yeah, I'd love to go there for rugby, but, you know, there was something else going on back in 2010.
I was at that game as well. I was at that game. I went to that game. I remember it. I was at that game.
Yeah, that was a good tour. It was. All white games. But anyway, my biggest, the DMAC factor tomorrow morning, Piney, he hasn't, you know, the Wolves are at the door a bit still. I think he's their current guy, but this is the ultimate time for him to show he can drive us around in a test match against the best team in the world, pressure test. You know, I was talking to someone, you know, Lima Sifuanga rock up there on his first test and had a blinder. It's time for DMAC to, you know, put all the critics like me, you know, in the sea, and I'm desperate for him to do well. But all I got in my mind, because I'm a pessimist, is a couple of intercept passes, because they got a lightning backline out there this test match. You know, there's guys like Creel and Alenda, and they're not there. They got all the quick boys. There's Colby sniffing around. Arenz is back. You know, these guys love feeding off the crumbs and whatnot. So I'm so desperate for DMAC to have a blinder, to be honest, Piney.
Yeah, so am I. So am I. And as I've said a couple of times on the show, I'm really pleased that they've stuck with him. Basically, they've said, look, you're our 10. And this is the sixth straight start. Only Adi Savia has also started all six test matches so far this year. They've given him time in the saddle. You're right, Apata Hama. It's his biggest test, easily his biggest test of the year, and maybe ever, you know. And look, this might be his turning point. This might be the test where we say, you know what, he is the future number 10 for us at this, in this World Cup cycle, regardless of whether Richie Moonga comes back, regardless of whether Bowden plays a bit there. If he has a if he guides us around tomorrow morning and plays a large part in winning that test match, I reckon it'll be a turning point for DMAC.
Yeah, I agree. But yeah, I love these 3 AM tests too. Not many people do, but no, I dig getting up, you know. Put up a bit of a feed on, and so yeah, looking forward to it. Love these test matches. They're always the best.
Indeed, mate. Good to chat to you as always. Give us a yell tomorrow if you get the chance and we can review it together, pessimistically or optimistically or whatever happens. Always good to chat to you. Hey, Peter, how are you?
Oh, g'day there, Piney. Yes, I was over there in 1976. I was the mascot, the All Black mascot.
You were what? The mascot?
Yes, I ran out on the field on most of the games for the whole tour. There, I had a Kiwi head on, and I ran around the ground and ran on the field there. It was a fabulous tour. Dick Evans led the tour, and we had had a great lot of people with us. Even had Ron King, the New Zealand captain from the West Coast in about 1935. He was with us, and we had a great time. And we had the three tests we had there in 76. Andy Leslie, of course, was the captain too of the tour. So I've made great friends with Andy and knew him beforehand. We lost the first test at Durban, which was at sea level, I think it was 16-7, and then we were up to Bloemfontein, second test, and that was getting up to altitude 15-9. And then we had a couple of midweek wins, and we were getting quite confident. And then by the third test, it was at Ellis Park, and 75,000 people there. We got Sid Going got a try in the first 5 minutes of the game, and we were all excited. We thought, we're going to beat them. We're going to beat them now. We're going really well. It was 9-8. 9-8 at half time to the Springboks, and we still thought we had a show. And blast, it ended up 15-14.
Peter, did you run out at Ellis Park with 75,000 people? Were you dressed as a Kiwi? Kiwi, or did you just have a Kiwi hat on?
No, I had the head on, and I had a brownish T-shirt, you know, with a all black thing. And I did the same in UK in 72-73. I led the teams out on the field there as a mascot, ran around Cardiff Arms Park and all the different ones. I've had a great career.
And how did you get the job? How did you get the job?
Dick Evans, he was the he was the leader, tour leader of these All Black tours, and he got permission from the New Zealand Rugby Union for me to be able to do these things. And you know, I was on Parc des Princes over in France, and the Barbarian game in the UK. It's been a great life.
Did you have to wear your Kiwi head on the plane, or were you able to just go as yourself?
We did most of the touring around in South Africa was by bus. You know, we went by bus. But if when it was in the UK, well, you know, it was flowing over to the UK, and the actual head is at the Palmerston North Museum, the Kiwi head, which was the same head in UK and in South Africa. But I was able to save it.
I can't believe they don't still do it, Peter. I think it would. Imagine you running out there now with the Kiwi head on. You'd be a hit.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, and of course, I sort of did my apprenticeship with the Wellington Supporters Club as Leo the Lion. I was the reserve Leo the Lion, and doing midweek games when the Gary Amies couldn't do it. So I was sort of used to that sort of thing.
So you were only the reserve for Leo the Lion, but you got the top gig as the travelling Kiwi.
Yes, I got the top job, and even Terry McLean in his book that he wrote on the tour said he didn't like the attitude of having a mascot on the All Black tour. So I didn't get a good write up from Terry McLean in his book, but I did my job.
Peter, amazing story. Amazing story. One of many in your life, I know. Good to chat to you, mate. I would love to see that done now. A throwback to the old days. Get Peter's brown T-shirt and his Kiwi head and get him out there at a Chockers Eden Park. 22 away from 2. We'll take a break. 2-2 in the second set between Popperin and Djokovic. Alexei Popperin's won the first set over Djokovic on Arthur Ashe Stadium. Popperin, the Australian, of course. Speaking of our friends across the Taz, Dan Lonergan, off the bench for Adam Peacock when we come back.
The Tough Questions Off the Turf Weekend Sport with Jason Pine and GJ Gardner Holmes, New Zealand's most trusted home builder. News Talk ZB.
What are we, 18 and a half away from 2? Adam Peacock, our regular Australian correspondent, getting a couple of weeks' well-deserved rest. But what a man to have coming off the bench, Australian freelance sports journalist Dan Lonergan. How are you, mate?
G'day, Jason. Thanks so much for having me on. It's a pleasure to be on. Great to have a chat. So much going on in the world of sport in Australia, in New Zealand, and around the world. So looking forward to it. Really appreciate it.
No, it's good to have you with us. I've had to drag you away from the tennis, though, haven't I, with your man Alexei Popperin, a set to love up over Novak Djokovic, and he's got a break in the second set as well. He could beat Djokovic.
Yeah, he's going really well. We know that Alcaraz is out, and we know that Hubie Hurkacz was beaten by the Australian two O'Connell. So it's been a terrific tournament for the Australian men so far. For the first time, Jason, in nearly 30 years, we've got four Australian men into the third round of the US Open, and Popperin is the one that's coming. We know that Dimonor's been a good player for a long time, top 10. He's missed the past 6 or 7 weeks with a hip injury he suffered at Wimbledon, forcing him out of the quarterfinals. But Popperin won an ATP tournament in Canada, and he's ready, you think, to maybe just make an impact. He's the 30th seed for the tournament. You wonder whether Novak Djokovic, we've said this before, might be on the way down, but, I mean, we would be silly if we were to write him off completely. We know he's a great player. Great start by Alexei Popperin, and this would be the biggest win of his career outside that tournament win if he was to get over Novak Djokovic. And you'd have Alcaraz out, Djokovic out, and Tsitsipas, of course, was beaten by Kokkinakis, who then showed his inconsistency losing the second round, another Australian. So already the seed's starting to fall by the wayside and opening the draw up for the men's tournament. But a long way to go yet, but a great start by Alexei.
What's the latest with Nick Kyrgios? Is he going to play again or is he done? What's the story with Nick Kyrgios?
That's a very good question, Jason. I remember when my late mum was alive, she always thought that he wasn't going to play much, that maybe there were some issues mentally. And look, I think he's become a very good commentator, but we'd love to see him again. He's always injured. There always seems to be an excuse. He gets himself up for the Australian Open and generally plays the Australian Open, asked to play on the third of the courts, which is the John Cain Arena, and he always fires up out there, gets a huge crowd on his side out there, and gets through 3 or 4 rounds, and then you don't see him again, Jason, for the rest of the year. The body doesn't allow him to play, or the mind doesn't allow him to play. I think we've seen the best of him. I think he's going to be an unfulfilled talent, which is very sad. Unlike a Dimonor, who's got the most out of his ability, there's no doubt, Jason, that in my humble opinion, that Nick Kyrgios is a better player than Alex Dimonor talent-wise, but I'm not sure he wants it enough. And I think that's why there's always injuries or those mental demons are in the road stopping him from fulfilling the talent that he was possessed with and given.
All right, we'll keep eyes on Alexei Popperin, absolutely, and the other Australians as the tournament progresses. Can I ask about AFL? We're through the regular season into quarterfinals, elimination finals, etc. I'm looking at this table. Sydney Swans, Port Adelaide, Geelong, Greater Western Sydney Giants, just one Victorian team in the top four, then the Brisbane Lions fifth. What's happened to the Victorian teams?
Well, that's a very good question, Jason. Hopefully the reception's all right as I go under the tunnel covering my way to local footy here. But this is Melbourne. We've got tunnels everywhere. But, yeah, look, that's a really good question. It's such a national competition. I know the AFL's delighted. It is the most even season that we have had in the history of the competition. I mean, you don't know from week to week who's going to win. You don't know from week to week who's going to fall off the perch. Sydney had their bad match 5 or 6 weeks out from the end of the season. But you're right. I mean, yes.
Oh, have we fallen victim to one of those tunnels? I'm just going to pop you on hold, Dan. Hopefully you can come back when you're on the other side of the tunnel. Have you got us there, mate?
That's okay.
Yep, no, I've got you there now. You're back with us?
Sorry, Jason. Yeah, I'm just going under the Eastern Tunnel in Melbourne, which is very busy. But we're not far away from being at the other end. I appreciate your listeners and yourself being so patient. But I was just saying the Carlton were a very, very good side, and then they've fallen away in the last 6 or 7 weeks. And I thought they were a big chance of playing in the grand final, but they're now 8. So, look, the interstate teams have done really well. And if you are an interstate team and you get an opportunity to host finals like Sydney, although they're playing GWS, which takes away that advantage, the other Sydney team, and Port Adelaide have got home finals, but Port Adelaide have been poor in finals, you should be able to take advantage of that. It's a bit different for the Melbourne-based teams. Like the Western Bulldogs generally play their home games at Docklands, but they're playing Hawthorn, who play their home games at the MCG, so that takes away that advantage. And if Geelong get through their first final, they'll play a final at the MCG. So it does favour the interstate teams if you're able to get through. But to answer why they're a bit better than the Melbourne-based teams, good question. I mean, the Melbourne-based teams have had their chances. Melbourne were good for a little while, they fell away. Essendon were good for a while, they fell away. We even saw St Kilda play some good footy, but the interstate teams probably a little bit more consistent. But who's going to win the flag, Jason? I've got no idea. Any of the 8 teams, even Carlton, despite all their injuries, could do the job on the day. So I think it's going to be one of the best final series we've ever had. I wouldn't have a clue who's going to win any of the first week of the finals next week.
No, that's the way you want it. No such problems for the Storm, though, in the NRL. Well clear at the top with a game to go. They will finish as minor premiers, go into the final series as favourites to win it again. The Storm, what's been your assessment of them, Dan? From this side of the Tasman, they've been very, very good.
Oh, they're an outstanding side, Jason. I mean, we've got to give them credit. I mean, in Melbourne, we do give them credit. Again, they probably fly under the radar a bit because AFL is king in this town. But I think when you look at the Melbourne Storm, what they've done under Craig Bellamy, they've always presented as being a very, very good side. I know they've won 3 titles. They had 2 taken away from them because they breached the salary cap. But they've generally finished top 3 or top 4. Sometimes they've struggled in the first week of the finals and then bowed out in the preliminary. That might be an area that they'd want to address a little bit. But in home and away football, they're right up there. And again, they've been the best side. They beat Penrith a couple of weeks ago and what was a terrific game of rugby league, and of course Nathan Cleary suffered that injury, which might stop them from making it 4 in a row, the Panthers, but they have, of course, overnight done the job to make sure they finish top 4 and get that all-important double chance. But they're just well organised, and they find replacements for players. Craig Bellamy's able to make his players buy into what he's trying to set up and what he's trying to organise. He's just a very, very good coach, and I think even though he does get a bit fired up and there's a lot of fire and brimstone in the way he delivers his messages, and he's very fit, and it's a grueling pre-season campaign that he puts his players through and he puts himself through, he has the players playing for him every single time, and that's why they've got a great record, and they've still got the hunger. They probably need to win another premiership with the record they've got and the number of times they present the top 4, and they've got a big chance this year. They've been the most consistent side. Certainly Penrith are a good side. They won a lot of close games this year, Penrith. I wonder whether the hunger's dropped off a bit and they need Nathan Cleary back. We know the Roosters are a good side. We know Cronulla are playing well. The Bulldogs got beaten by Manly in a ribbing contest last night. They're both pretty good sides. Good to see those two traditional teams, even though they might be hated by a lot of people in the competition if you don't follow the Bulldogs or Manly. But good to see them back. And obviously St George have got a poor points differentiation, but they're settled as well. And then of course, there's a lot of teams playing today, such as the Raiders, such as the Dolphins, also the Broncos are still in contention to finish 8th, but I reckon they're just making up the numbers. But Melbourne Storm at the moment, with 1 game to go and they rested 11 in their loss on Thursday night, they'll get a lot of those players back. I think Craig Bellamy would like them to play, including Ryan Pappenhausen, to make sure that they're ready to go and in good form come the first week of the finals, which I'll host.
All right. And just to finish, you're coming off the back of a very successful Olympic Games. The Paralympics are on now. Already 3 gold medals for Australia, a couple at the track cycling and at the swimming pool as well. You're always good in the swimming. Many more finals to come. You got high hopes for a good medal tally at the Paralympics too?
Well, I think they're aiming, they're 6th at the moment. It's early days, Jason. I think they're aiming for top 5. We know Thomas Gallagher's won gold in the men's freestyle S10, 50 metres, which was a good result for him. And 2 terrific results in the cycling overnight. Emily Petrikova has defended her Olympic title. She won in Tokyo in 2021 in the cycling, the 3,000-metre pursuit. And Corey Boddington, in his first ever Olympic Paralympic Games, has won gold as well. So we've got 7 medals at the moment. It was also good to see the rugby wheelchair team that have had a really tough build-up to these Olympic Games, had to qualify in the last event and to get through, and they've done it. They, of course, won the Olympic Games on a couple of occasions. They lost their first game to the reigning Olympic gold medalist in Great Britain, to beat France overnight. So there's still a chance, obviously, the basketball as well. But look, I'm expecting in the pool a lot of medals, because that's the strength. And Madison Desario has also qualified in her event, the 3,000 metres in the track, and she's expected to be one of Australia's brightest hopes. So, look, you never like to put too much pressure on them, but Australia have always done well in the Paralympics, and again, I'm expecting a pretty strong performance, Jason.
Terrific stuff, Dan. Thanks so much for joining us this afternoon, mate. Safe travels across Melbourne and through all those tunnels. Look forward to catching up again sometime soon.
Good on you, Jason. Appreciate having me on. All the best.
Great to have you on, Dan. Thanks indeed. Dan Lonergan there, Australian freelance sports journalist, hugely experienced, and great to have him off the bench for our Australian spot here on Weekend Sport. 8 away from 2, just a quick check on the tennis. Casper Ruud is through in 5 sets. He has eventually won his match. Alexei Poprin, 6-4 and 4-3 ahead, 40-30, serving for 5-3 in the second set, Alexei Poprin against Novak Djokovic. Is there an upset coming? We'll keep eyes on that for you. Weekend Sport, 8-2.
Analysing every view from every angle in the sporting world. Weekend Sport with Jason Pine. Call 0800 80 1080. News Talk ZB.
5-2. Okay, Poprin's won the 8th game of the second set. He is 5-3 ahead, Djokovic serving for 5-4. So Alexei Poprin will have the chance to serve for the second set. He won the first set 6-4. So with a chance in the next little while to go into a 2-sets-to-love lead over the second-seeded Serb Novak Djokovic. Casper Ruud, as I say, is through. He made hard work of it, I've got to say, against the unseeded Chinese player Juncheng Shan. He lost the first 2 sets, did Casper Ruud, before winning the next 3. So he got through okay. Djokovic has won the 9th game of the second set, and there was just a bit of concern over Poprin as he went for a return and just maybe tweaked his ankle, just landed rather awkwardly. Hopefully he's okay. He's about to serve for the second set. After 2 o'clock, our coaching guru Wayne Goldsmith. I wanted to talk to Wayne about the, not specifically the situation with Leon McDonald leaving the All Blacks coaching group, but more generally about coaching groups and whether it's necessary that they always agree. Can disagreement and challenging ideas actually be a good thing? Wayne Goldsmith on that after 2 o'clock. We'll also talk to Futsal Whites coach Marvin Eakins, our New Zealand men's futsal team, about to head off to their World Cup in the next little while. And we'll head back to South Africa. Elliot Smith, our rugby editor, joins us for a yarn.
The only place for the big names, the big issues, the big controversies, and the big conversations. It's all on Weekend Sport with Jason Pine on your home of sport, News Talk ZB.
Hello and welcome back, or welcome in, 2:06. Jason Pine and Annie McDonald with you till 3, then the Weekend Collective takes over. We're only 13 hours away from kickoff. We're sort of edging our way there, aren't we? Towards 3 a.m. tomorrow morning, All Blacks Springboks. Elliot Smith has the call. He joins us this hour just to put a final cap on our preview of this one. Very shortly, I want to talk to Wayne Goldsmith, our coaching guru on Weekend Sport. He joins us regularly on a range of topics, and I was keen to chat to Wayne about the dynamic of a coaching group. Obviously, with the departure of Leon McDonald a week or so ago, as I said before the news, I don't necessarily want to talk specifically about that case, but more generally about whether it's okay for coaches to disagree inside their environment, if challenging ideas is actually a good thing. And Can players tell if the coaches are not on the same page? Wayne Goldsmith standing by to chat to us. I also want to catch up with coach of the Futsal Whites, Marvin Eakins. They're about to head off for their first ever Futsal World Cup. Our men's futsal team, it's in Uzbekistan. Marvin Eakins has named his squad for that tournament, did in the week past. He'll have a chat to us shortly too. Your calls and correspondence continue to be welcome. 0800 8010 89292 on text. Updating live sport. Otago have hammered Taranaki in the Farah Palmer Cup. 60 points to 17. What a hiding. Bunnings MPC. They're about to get underway or just have at Albany, North Harbour and Counties Manukau. Taranaki Otago at 2:35. And in the Heartland Championship, I can tell you that it has not been a happy hosting of North Otago for Whited Upper Bush and Masterton. 10 minutes into the second half, and it's North Otago 55-5 ahead of Whited Upper Bush. So, yeah, the Masterton faithful will not be that enamoured with that, I'm sure. 2:08 it is. Oh, and Popperin's won the second set, as you heard in the sports news. So Alexei Popperin, 2 sets to love ahead of Novak Djokovic. Into the third set they go on Arthur Ashe, with Novak Djokovic now in a fight to stay in the US Open. 2:09, as we always do, though, at around about this time on a Saturday and Sunday afternoon. Let's get you across some of the stuff you might have missed. Andy McDonald's world famous In Case You Missed It segment. Starting with cycling, a stage win at La Vuelta for Canadian champion Mike Woods.
This team still haven't won a stage in this Vuelta a España so far, and Mike Woods is going to put a change to that. Michael Woods, the Canadian road race champion, is going to win stage 13 of the Vuelta. 3 stage wins in the Vuelta make that 4 in all Grand Tours.
A bit closer to home in the NRL, the Manly Sea Eagles putting on a dominant display against the Bulldogs last night.
Brown to Cherry Evans. Cut out ball there. It's Garrick Whiting.
And winning at 34-22, no surprises between Penrith and South Sydney.
He's enormous, Isaiah. Here's Luai now into the backfield, looking for Taruva. He sets sail again. Taruva has a double in the space of 2 minutes.
Penrith running away with it, winning 34-12 to the NPC. Southland coming from a long way back to beat their distance rivals Northland in Whangarei.
It's an awkward bounce for Northland, and it'll come into the arms of Van Booth. There you go, the bounce of a rugby ball, not contained by Northland, and it bounces into the arms of Van Booth. Down to Albert, he kicks it into touch, and it's the Southland Stags that will take the victory.
Incredible, really. 31-26 they won it. They were 26-7 behind at half-time. So what's that, 24 unanswered points to win it? And our first medal at the Paralympic Games in Paris has gone to cyclist Anna Taylor.
Anna, the catch.
The gun will go.
And that is the gun. That's the race. Anna Taylor went out fast, but couldn't sustain that pace. It was Taylor who will take silver for New Zealand.
Breaking down the Hail Marys and the epic fails. Weekend Sport with Jason Pine, Newstalk, ZB.
I might have spoken too soon. Novak Djokovic has broken Alexei Popperin in the second game of the third set. He's 2 love ahead and serving for 3 love now. So a bit more to come in the Popperin-Djokovic match on Arthur Ashe. Major upheaval in the All Blacks in the last 10 days. Leon McDonald leaving the coaching group after the second test against Argentina. And it brought into focus some wider questions around coaching groups and the dynamics at play within them. What happens when coaches working together differ on key principles? Can those differences be resolved? And can disagreement and challenging ideas actually be a good thing? How disruptive is it meantime for the players when they may be hearing mixed messages and are potentially aligned to one coach or another through having played under them in previous sides? Well, to provide some perspective, the only voice I know to give us the top drawer analysis is our Weekend Sport coaching guru, Wayne Goldsmith. Wayne, thanks for joining us on this topic, which I'm, you know, really interested to hear your thoughts on. Pretty simple question, first of all. Do coaches who work together actually have to be friends?
Well, the short answer is no, Piney. In a perfect world, yes. In a perfect world, they get up on
game day. They have breakfast together and talk about footy. They go and have a game of golf or a game of squash. And there's this camaraderie, genuine friendship and affection. But it's not essential. If you think about coaching as a workplace, that we've all been in workplaces that have really hummed, that have been effective, but we don't necessarily like each other or know each other's partners and kids, and we don't do those things, but we're professionals and we just find a way of getting on. Friendship, getting on well as human beings and celebrating an authentic care and connection, that's a bonus. In the end, is are they getting the job done? That's the they're hired to do a job, which is, in that case, create an environment where success is almost an inevitability because of the expectations of the New Zealand public and rugby public of the All Blacks team.
So let's just say then that coaches aren't necessarily friends. And as you've outlined, it's not absolutely crucial. It's a bonus, but not absolutely crucial. How important is it, though, for those coaches to present a united front to their players?
Oh, absolutely. What you've said there, that's the real issue. So I know my experience working in the actual coaching rooms in rugby and super rugby, even up to test level in AFL and definitely in rugby league. The general thing is that in what we say the coaches room, which is coaches come in, cup of coffee, and they start talking about selections or the next game or strategies or recruitment, whatever it might be. The general rule is once that door is closed, it's let's get into it. And I should be able to, in an effective environment where there's good leadership, good connections, consistency of relationships and the way we work with each other, I should be able to look at the head coach and say, mate, you're wrong on this. And the head coach will look back at me and say, tell me why, and let's bash it out. And, I've been in those rooms, and it's got heated, and it's got challenging. But the key is, as soon as the hand goes on the doorknob again to leave the room, one voice, united front, consistent messages, no ambiguity, and very, very clear. And, mate, I've seen those rooms almost get the throwing thing stage and whole range of stuff. And it's robust and it's vigorous. And it has to be, because if the people charged with leading the team can't be honest and direct with each other, then once they leave the room, there is the opportunity for ambiguity and different messages. So you get it all out, you thrash it out in honesty, with respect, of course, and real integrity, but you get it all out, and then as soon as the door handle goes, it's one voice, one team, one message, no ambiguity, absolutely clear. And that's a very, very healthy professional coaching environment.
Yeah, and just as you're saying that, I'm envisaging these discussions where, you know, there is robust dialogue and disagreement, obviously. That's better, Wayne, isn't it, than just a bunch of assistants who nod their head all the time?
And it has to be, Piney, because look, I'll give you an example. I had a wonderful opportunity to work with Racing Victoria for a few years, and I mentored and coached, believe it or not, their stewards and their integrity team. And the way that the chief steward, Terry Bailey, who's just an amazing guy, the way he would put it, he said, we're about to tell people that the race was legal. We're about to say correct weight. That has to be a decision that our group has made that's been tested, because once we make the decision, the media, the public, the jockey, the trainer, the owner, everyone's going to rip it to pieces and look for any tiny flaw to try and prove that we were wrong. So he said, in our decision-making as a group of stewards, we have to be direct, honest, critical, confronting. We have to be able to be those things so that the decision we make collectively has been rigorously tested, challenged, and then when we make it, if someone wants to dispute it, that's great, but man, oh man, we've tapped into the collective expertise of some really good people. And that's what you see in great footy teams, is that the power of honesty and the power of trust and the power of that directness to challenge each other makes the decision stronger. And mate, quite often the head coach is wrong. Having a group of people to say it, but do it not just, hey, you're wrong and we don't like you because we don't like your hair or you smell a bit. Well, I'm not talking about that stuff. I'm saying intelligent discussion, really vigorous, very direct, and saying, "Coach, I think you got it wrong. Here's the evidence. Here's the data. Here's what I've come up with." Head coach thinks, reviews it, puts it through the process, and might say, "Look, I'm sorry, I disagree, and ultimately it's my head on the chopping block, and I choose to go this way, or my decision is." But the more vigorous and the more direct and the more honest that those relationships are and the more direct the conversation is, the stronger and in all likelihood, the better the decision is when they step out of the room. And that's what you want, is a decision that's been tested that will withstand criticism, the opposition's attacks, and all those things once they leave the room.
Okay, so you've outlined the healthy environment there, and you spoke before about once the hand goes on the doorknob to open the door out into the playing group, that there has to be the united front. If there's not, Wayne, do you think players can sense disharmony in a coaching group?
Oh, I think they do. I call it the mum and dad can have a bowl of ice cream routine, because I think some players just get on with it. They're professionals. They get on with, but I think some of them, they want a particular thing, so they might want to play in a position. One coach says, "Nah, look, I think you're absolutely where you should be. You should be a nine or a three, or you should be up front, whatever it is." And the coach says, "Well, no, actually, I think I want to be another side." And they go looking for an alternate view or someone who'll listen to them, or maybe someone that'll give them a different perspective. That becomes a danger, because then the player's thinking, "Hang on, if I go to mum," in the same analogy, if I go to mum says, "Yes, you can have ice cream." Dad says, "You can't," or says, "Go ask your mother." Player's not quite sure. One of the greatest things I've ever heard Eddie Jones say, he said, "The secret to success in professional rugby is role clarity. People must know very clearly and very accurately what their job is, what they're supposed to do, when they're supposed to do it, and to what standard it has to be done." And he said, "You go through any team in the world where there's ambiguity, uncertainty, two messages, the teams inevitably fail." So, yeah, it's got to be very consistent. Those things have got to be there, because players will sense it. I have no doubt whatsoever that players, they listen to the language, they look at the body language, they look at the way the coaches interact. And, oh, I don't know, mate, no matter how confidential you think things are, inside a footy club, they all leak. Everybody, right up to international level, everybody knows what everybody else knows within 30 seconds. What did somebody say once? If you don't know what's going on, wait 30 seconds. Everybody knows what's going on. The problem with it is, though, is that if there's different voices, different views, it's like the old military saying, anything that can be misunderstood will be misunderstood. And then you've got holes all over the place where people are getting different messages.
A phrase you've used a lot in our conversations, Wayne, is when there's a decision to make or a choice to make. You've said you can accept it, change it, or leave it. And in this case, obviously, they decided that change had to happen, or in fact, someone had to leave, and that was Leon McDonald. Is there merit in the fact they did that quickly rather than let this sort of linger?
I think so, and usually it's iceberg principle. What we're seeing, what we're hearing, what's got out into the public, remember, that's been shielded, protected. It's been filtered by a whole mechanism of PR, marketing, a whole group that's designed to keep things as tight as they possibly can and not just be completely in the public domain. And that's in any company, and not just in footy teams. So what you're seeing has probably been suspected, known, dealt with behind closed doors for maybe weeks or months. I don't know. I have no insight or any direct relationship with Rugby New Zealand or the All Blacks. But I suspect if it's got to that stage, it's more than likely been something that's accumulated over a period of time. And there's that wonderful phrase, which is think slowly but act fast. I think you get to a point where you go, this is going to create or is creating division, uncertainty, lack of clarity, which is now being reflected on field. We've got to make a decision. Let's make it fast and move on. Obviously, with all transparency and integrity and respect for the player, for the coach, and making sure that they're being treated appropriately and upfront. Because, mate, sometimes it doesn't happen that way. I know an NRL coaching friend of mine,
I think I might have shared this story with you previously, but went to the NRL team in the morning. CEO called him in and said, mate, we've made a decision overnight. You're out. And this guy, this big burly guy standing behind you, is going to escort you to your office, put your stuff in a box and leave. Your passwords have been changed. And by the way, we've already told the players, and we've got a little note here saying that you're not allowed to directly talk to the players about this issue for a period of time as part of your severance. So sometimes it's done really badly, with no respect for the coach and with a real lack of integrity. Other times it's, look, it's not working. We need to make a change. You know it's not working. Let's move on really quickly. The hardest thing, though, mate, is so much of this game that we're in is about the relationship between the coach and the athletes. And it can feel like you're losing family members. That's the hardest thing quite often, I think, is, you know, you can always get another job, particularly a high-level New Zealand rugby coach. God, you guys are in so much demand all over the world. But on a personal level, you feel like, you know, you've spent all this time building relationships and friendships with players, and then it's gone. That's the part that really hurts the individual coach.
I want to finish with this absolutely brilliant line that you sent when I asked you about this this segment. And you said, you can't beat an opponent by punching them with one hand while you're punching yourself with the other. I thought that was absolutely terrific. So unity of purpose and unity of action, unity of everything really, is probably what it all boils down to, right? You've got to be unified.
Well, it is. And you know, the issue with the All Blacks, as always, they're the team that everybody wants to beat because they're so damn good. I mean, I'm a big fan of New Zealand sport generally, but if you're a coach, your first mindset is, yeah, we're going okay over here. We've beaten a couple of teams in Europe, or we're going all right, but what would we do against the All Blacks? And everybody's coming after you all the time. We know how good the South Africans are. We know how good the Irish are. Everybody wants to beat you guys. And as a consequence, what you do has to be unified, very clear and very strong. And you can't, it's like a boxer. You can't be, no matter what sort of a boxer you are, you could be Mike Tyson times five. You can't be in the ring sparring and putting out your jab hand while you're giving yourself an uppercut. It just doesn't make sense. And knowing that so many teams are coming to beat you because you're so good, it has to be with both hands out in front and fighting with both hands on deck, which means unity of direction and purpose and all those things, which your teams have been known for so long. And some of the great work Gilbert and Noak has done over the years, and when Smithy and Hanso and all those great, great coaches, and Graham Henry and all those incredible, it just seemed like the strength and the unity in every area of the team was what gave you a winning edge, in addition, obviously, to player talent and everything else. But you just screamed unity in the black jumper, and I think that's has been and always will be the key.
Wayne, your insight and analysis is, as always, greatly appreciated by me and by our listeners as well. Thanks so much for taking the time. Are you an All Blacks fan, though? Would that be fair or not?
Look, I'd watch the All Blacks unless they're up against the Wallabies, in which case I just sit there crying into my beer glass. But no, it's just, I think you've got to appreciate just the consistency of execution at speed and power. I mean, everybody, you know, over the years, it's South Africa have beaten you at different times, and from time to time you get a challenge. But if you go back over 20, 30, 40 years that I've been watching rugby, the ability of a nation of 3.5-4 million people to produce that level of skill, which is consistently executed with that much power and speed, is still remarkable. I don't think there's another sporting story like it. So absolutely, but yeah, mate, obviously when they're up against the green and gold jumper, I try to watch it and look at the screen. I try to get some level of enjoyment and just appreciate that, you know, at least if we get within 50 points, we're quite happy.
Again, Wayne, thanks for joining us. Always a great pleasure.
Always my pleasure, Piney. Talk to you soon.
Yeah, talk soon, mate. Thanks indeed. Wayne Goldsmith there, just so much wisdom in everything he says. We're very lucky to have him join us so regularly on Weekend Sport. If you like what you heard from Wayne and would like to find out more about him, he's got a couple of books out as well, writes articles. His website is wgcoaching.com, wgcoaching.com. 2:27, checking in on the tennis. Djokovic leads Popperin 3-1 in the third set, although Djokovic is serving and at its advantage Popperin, so he could break back here in the fifth game of the third set. If you're just jumping on board with this game, Alexei Popperin, the Australian, has won the first two sets over Novak Djokovic, so pretty pivotal time in this match as Djokovic looks to fight back. And we might just stay with this point. I think just I'm not allowed to commentate it. We don't have the rights to do that. But no, Popperin has won that game. He's broken back, so he will now serve for 3-all in the third set. It's getting interesting at Flushing Meadows. 2:28. When we come back, we're going to talk some futsal for the first time. This is indoor football, of course. For the first time, New Zealand will send a team to the Futsal Men's World Cup in Uzbekistan next month, which is basically tomorrow. Their coach is Marvin Eakins. He's going to have a chat to us after this.
The biggest names in sport are on Weekend Sport with Jason Pine and GJ Gardner Holmes, New Zealand's most trusted home builder. News Talk ZB.
News Talk ZB and Weekend Sport, 29-3. Next month, so basically September, New Zealand will compete at the FIFA Futsal World Cup for the very first time, having won the Oceania qualifying tournament back in October.
Oh, there's the play and there's the shot from Antimanov. He scores! Mike Antimanov with a play and a half right there. What a score for Mike Antimanov. His first goal for New Zealand has come at a hugely important time. And how well did he execute that play? It's an absolute heartbreaker for the Solomon Islands.
So New Zealand qualified, that's last October, October obviously 2023. The 2024 Futsal World Cup is underway from September 14 in Uzbekistan. Futsal White's head coach is Marvin Eakins. He's named a squad of 14 players. 10 are based domestically, 4 of them based internationally. Marvin Eakins is with us. Were there any tough choices you had to make, Marvin, to finalise your squad of 14?
Yeah, there's a group of 3 or 4 players that have missed out that were right on the edge, and they've kind of sacrificed a lot to give themselves the best opportunity to be involved. Unfortunately, with the World Cup, we can only take 14 players. Otherwise, it would have been nice to have brought them along and had, I guess, a bigger squad to choose from.
Tell us about the blend in your squad between youth and experienced players.
Yeah, there is quite a blend. A large chunk of the team that was around 4 years ago has generally moved on, with Dylan Manikin, the captain, still being involved, Stephen Ashby, and Mickey Malavuk, who was kind of a late surprise, I guess, this year. Being the ripe age of 41. And then at the other end, we've got a plethora of young players, all under the age of kind of 25. There's some exciting lads in there that I think will be keen to take their opportunity.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about Mickey, because I had him late 30s. So 41, man, that's terrific. You clearly value the experience that he brings, but also are you confident that that those 41-year-old legs will still be up to it?
No doubt. Mickey's the kind of guy, if you know him, that will be doing pull-ups in his kitchen. So he's got the body of an 18-year-old. So he's certainly looked after himself and been ready to go. But he's in a specialist position. He's in the pivot role as well. And he's got a few campaigns under his belt. So, yeah, he's a good personality to have around the team.
How much has the game changed? I want to talk about the World Cup in a minute. But how much has the game changed since you became involved in it at the very top level?
It's been a good change, I think, for us. What we've found now is that a lot of the players are just dedicating their time fully to futsal, in the sense that they're not also trying to deliver on a football career as well, which is kind of how it was in the past. And that's pretty massive for some of these younger guys as well to make that call pretty early and try and pursue a career in futsal. And I think with that, we're starting to get people that are students of the game that are watching, learning all the time, and it's starting to flow into, I guess, that the high performance end, because there is underneath this group, I know there's a really good youth contingent of players that will kind of be biting at these players' heels if they don't keep applying themselves and keep pushing themselves.
So what does your crystal ball tell you? Does it tell you that in, I don't know, 10 years maybe even not that long, that there'll be futsal players who never play 11-a-side outside? I mean, I look at a guy like Dylan Manicum, you know, and what he does on the grass in an 11-a-side environment. Do you think in the future it might be that guys and women just play futsal?
I think it'll have to be if the game really wants to kick on, but not until they're of a good age. I mean, when you're in those teenage years, you should be cracking on with all the different sports, right? And football being one of those. I think the big challenge that futsal will have is making sure that we can offer careers for our athletes, because it's especially in the football game, you've got the opportunity of university scholarships in America, and the opportunity or the vision of going pro in the Premier League, as we've seen recently. So things like that can be quite enticing. But I think what we're starting to see now is that there are a handful of guys, and there will be more that are pushing overseas to try and ply their trade, make a little bit of income, hopefully, and eventually that becomes a little bit more lucrative.
Let's look at the World Cup then. You're in a group with Spain, Kazakhstan and Libya. You need to finish top two or be one of the best third-placed finishers. How do you rate your chances of getting out of that group?
Well, two European teams with Spain and Kazakhstan makes life difficult. We have to be real. Spain will be trying to win the whole thing and be one of the favourites to do so. And Kazakhstan are a very, very strong side and have some unique tactics that we'll probably find a bit challenging once we get across there. Libya is a bit of an unknown. They kind of squeezed through. If I can say that, through their qualifying and upset Egypt when it mattered, and shows that I guess they've got something to them when it comes to dealing with pressure. But that's certainly our game we're targeting. It's the first one against Libya on the 15th. And I think if we can get a positive result there, then anything can happen in those games against Kazakhstan and Spain.
Will you have the opportunity, Marvin, for a decent build-up to the World Cup?
We're fortunate to have some games in Thailand in the lead-in, which will get us four games against some Asian opposition, which will be useful. We don't get many international games. I think every international sports team or athlete is always wanting more international games to test themselves, and we've certainly wanted that over the last few years to help us kind of build. So I think it's going to be important to challenge ourselves against the likes of Thailand, who are one of the strongest Asian teams, to kind of see how we could come across teams and styles that are similar to Libya.
And how special is it to be part of the first New Zealand side to go to a Futsal World Cup? I know the Futsal Ferns, the women, have just in the last little while qualified for their first one in the Philippines next year. But how cool is it to be the first New Zealand side to go to a Men's Futsal World Cup?
Yeah, it's been, for some of us, it's been quite the journey. For myself, it's since 2008. I've been trying to get there initially as a player and more recently as a coach. But even before me, our goalkeeper coach, Elias Billet, he was part of the 2014 that tried and missed out to with Australia taking that one when they were still in the Oceania region. So it's been a heck of a ride with lots of heartbreak and lots of stories along the way. But I think in the background, what's been important in New Zealand is that there's been a lot of development, a lot of opportunities for kids to play and build up their hours playing the game. And I think that's kind of led to, it was a matter of time for us to finally qualify. And I think the guys know that generally, that there's a bigger picture here and how this could kick on futsal, I guess, to the next step. Locally, but there's also an element of these guys have put in a lot of mahi themselves and have deserved this opportunity. So we don't want them having the weight of the country too much on them or the weight of futsal in the country, but I think it'll be in the back of all their minds.
Wonderful. Well, it's an exciting time for you, your support staff, and for these 14 players who are about to head off to the FIFA Futsal World Cup in Uzbekistan. Marvin, all the best, mate. Thanks for taking the time for a chat. Can't wait to see how it plays out for you.
Cheers, buddy.
Thanks, Marvin. Marvin Eakins there, coach of the Futsal Whites, our men's national futsal team. If you're unfamiliar with it, just think indoor football. That's basically what it is, but it is enormous. Absolutely enormous around the world, gaining in popularity in New Zealand as well. In fact, player numbers for indoor football, for futsal, are just going through the roof. And a lot of it is not club-based stuff, just a bunch of friends playing, you know, on a Wednesday night in a social league or something like that. But then there are obviously elite pathways as well, and New Zealand football and football associations all around the world are taking it a lot more seriously because it is building their participation base. They basically align the two. Football, in its normal sense, the outside version on grass or whatever it is, 11-a-side, futsal is becoming a huge part of the game here and all around the world. And the next World Cup for men next month, or starting on the 14th of September. Incidentally, our women, as I mentioned to Marvin Eakins there, have also qualified for the World Cup for the first time. In fact, it's the first ever Women's World Cup next year in the Philippines. We'll cover that off on the show tomorrow. 19 away from three. We'll circle back to the rugby. Get you to Joburg. Chat to our rugby editor, Elliot Smith, to wrap the show shortly.
Don't get caught offside. Call 0800 80 1080. Weekend Sport with Jason Pine and GJ Gardner Holmes, New Zealand's most trusted home builder. Newstalk ZB.
2:44, full commentary of the All Blacks Springboks game from 3 tomorrow morning with our rugby editor and match commentator, Elliot Smith, who's been with the All Blacks in Joburg all week. Elliot, what feeling do you get from the All Blacks ahead of what will be, I'm sure, a massive test match for them?
Yeah, it's interesting, Piney. Look, I spoke to Geordie Barrett earlier in the week and Terrell Lomax sort of in a one-on-one extended conversation where you learn a bit more about the player and also about how they're feeling about the game. And Terrell Lomax was fairly upfront and saying that, you know, they are underdogs for this game. But there's a sense in the team that obviously that they believe they can go to Ellis Park. Everything's against them, you know, recent form, the way the Springboks have been playing, 60,000 South African fans in the stands, everything like that, the altitude too. But speaking to him and to Geordie Barrett as well, who you know, played the old foe sort of line and their, you know, the biggest foe that they can face, I think there's a steely determination for this All Blacks team that they believe they're capable of delivering a result at Ellis Park and almost sort of embracing that underdog tag a little bit. That they feel that they've got, you know, given the results so far between the two sides and the fact they're playing the world champions for the first time since that World Cup final.
Do you think that World Cup final is being used in any way as motivation, even if they're not saying it?
I don't think so. Maybe for specific players, I'm sure Sam Kane maybe at the back of his mind has a desire to get a better outcome than what we saw in that World Cup final. And for a number of players, it's still there. But to a man this week that, you know, that said that it just it hasn't been mentioned in camp, but I'm sure you can't escape it. There'll be memories when they go out onto Ellis Park, you know, and see the Springboks jersey, see that dark green with gold trimmed Springboks jersey that, you know, the last time they played was in a World Cup final and the hurt that went along with that. Scott Barrett said earlier today that, you know, it's a game that he doesn't think he'll ever get over. So I think individually it'll play a part in their build-up, but sort of collectively as a team, it sounds like it hasn't been mentioned and hasn't been drawn upon for their build-up for this game. A lot's changed since then in terms of the coaching setup for the All Blacks, new captain, a lot of new backroom staff as well, and there's been changes to the Springboks too. So the All Blacks fairly keen on downplaying the significance of the World Cup final and very much looking forward rather than backwards.
If you, I guess, thought of a full-strength All Blacks team with everybody fit and available, and then you look at the team that's going to run out at Ellis Park, you land on a couple of players. I'm keen to get your thoughts on them. How big a test is this for Tamaiti Williams?
Yeah, huge. This is the biggest test that he'll face in his career to date. I think Piney, he's impressed in the opportunities that he's had. He seems to have been, I don't know if pigeonholed's the right word, but certainly he either starts or he doesn't get an opportunity too often on the bench. They seem pretty set on Fletcher Newell and Offit Tuangafasi backing up the starters, so it's hard to crack there. They've got a pretty good punch, they feel, in terms of the props, but I think it is a major opportunity for him on Sunday morning, New Zealand time. He's coming for Ethan de Groot. I think Tamaiti Williams is only improving as a scrummager. I think his work around the park is also on the improve as well. I thought he had a very good test last time out against Argentina in Auckland. But when you match up against the Springboks scrum and both these teams like using it as a weapon, we saw the All Blacks use it really well against England, a similarly strong scrummaging pack front row. So big test for Tamaiti Williams. You look at him and go, he's the kind of body frame that the All Blacks have been searching for. Ethan de Groot is, you know, still obviously the incumbent, but I think he can make some real inroads with a sort of statement performance over the next couple of weekends.
And Caleb Clark's got the knot on the left wing. He didn't get a lot of opportunities last year, did he? But and even at the start of this year, he probably thought he was behind the likes of Mark Talaia and others in the pecking order. Why do you think they've gone Caleb Clark, and how big a game is this for him?
Yeah, I think it's a big game for Caleb Clark to try and cement back that 11 jersey. You think back to the when he debuted for the All Blacks in 2020, and it felt like we had a new superstar on our hands, and the way he played, especially the Bledisloe against Australia at Eden Park that year. He was dynamic. He was exceptional. Since then, he struggled to sort of recapture those heights. But I think the hard running style of Caleb Clark, the big body, will be huge. He's great under the high ball as well. I really like this selection. I also actually like the way they've gone about it with Mark Talaia off the bench. I think he's still developing as a bench player, Mark Talaia, but you know, he's so slippery, isn't he? And you think about that coming on late in the game against tired defences. He's kind of the player that can break the line, can get through. Caleb Clark has been exceptional with his line breaks. His stats in Super Rugby speak to themselves this year. He had a very good Super Rugby season and built into it quite nicely with a hat-trick in the final. So in terms of cementing that 11 jersey, I think it's still firmly a live conversation. Mark Talaia is right there, and in fact, he'll be on the bench, of course, looking over. So big opportunity for Caleb Clark if the ball goes his way. It probably didn't go his way too often in that game at Eden Park, you know, last time out. So he'll be keen to get more opportunities in the game, and I'm sure try and, as I say, cement that jersey for the coming test matches.
And a lot's made of the fact that this game is at altitude. Johannesburg, Pretoria, obviously, are the two altitude grounds, if you like, compared to Cape Town, where you'll be next week. For the average person, like yourself, in Johannesburg, is the change in altitude obvious?
Yes, it is, yeah. I've noticed this week the air is a little thinner. Going up steps, you get a little more puffed out of breath than you probably should. You know, just you feel a little bit more tired, I think, is the way about it. And you're desperate for a bit more water than maybe you'd usually take on board. I find my mouth getting a little bit drier than it probably would throughout the times of the day. So I've been well armed with a water bottle to make sure of that. And I've had the dreaded altitude nosebleed as well. So I've had it all, Piney, over the last few days. But you do notice it. It is a different experience, and for a few of these players in the All Blacks, they won't have experienced it at least before we're sort of training earlier on in the week and landing on the ground. You know, there's been a number of players in the squad. You know, look at the bench and Cortez Ratama, Seven Penny Finau, who haven't travelled to South Africa before in Super Rugby because that opportunity doesn't exist anymore. So when you land in Johannesburg, it's not like you've had the experience of playing the Lions at Ellis Park and you know the way around the Highveld and gone to Loftus and played the Bulls. You're experiencing it for the first time. And as a civilian, you do notice those differences and the lungs burn a little bit deeper. I spoke to Geordie Barrett and he mentioned your lungs burn a little bit deeper earlier in a game than you would expect. And it's all new to some of those players in the All Black setup. So they have to be ready to combat it. I know it's been mentioned this week around some of those tactics you can use to improve and deny it for as long as you possibly can, but it's certainly something they'll have to combat on Saturday afternoon here in local time.
All right, keep the water bottle nice and handy, Elliot. Can't wait for your call in the early hours of New Zealand time. I really appreciate your work this week, and can't wait to see how it plays out at Ellis Park.
I'll stay well hydrated. Thanks, Piney.
Good on you, mate. Elliot Smith, our rugby editor and match commentator, 3 o'clock tomorrow morning, full commentary of the All Blacks Springboks test here on News Talk ZB. 8 to 3.
When it's down to the line, you make the call on 0800 80 10 80. Weekend Sport with Jason Pine, News Talk ZB.
4.5 to 3. That's us. Tim Beveridge after 3 with the Weekend Collective Saturday edition. Huge thanks to Andy McDonald for pulling the show together. We're back tomorrow to pick over the bones of whatever happens at Ellis Park. Looking forward to that. What's our exit song today, mate? Well,
Piney, nosebleeds at high altitude. As we move up from the Earth's surface, the internal pressure of the blood vessels is more than the outside pressure. This causes blood vessels to rupture. Thus, nose or ear bleeding takes place at high altitudes. There you go, Piney. A bit of a fact for you on the nosebleeds.
And, thank you, Ed.
And because it's all altitude chat, ain't no mountain high enough. We'll take us out today.
Love it. See you guys tomorrow at midday. Looking forward to chatting.
For more from Weekend Sport with Jason Pine, listen live to News Talk ZB weekends from midday or follow the podcast on iHeartRadio.